The following program contains medical procedures. Channel 9 recommends parental guidance.
Tonight on RPA, a critical operation for Keith. Has his bladder cancer gone too far?
They're not living in that situation, and they just...
Margaret and her husband search for the cause of her unusual epileptic attacks.
And if she's on a train, she can get out the wrong station or get in the wrong train or just do anything because she hasn't a clue what's going on when she has one of these.
And six-year-old Meredith begins laser treatment on her birthmark.
Can I have a look at it? Can we have a little look? Now, how long's this been present?
Well, since birth, her skin was quite pink at birth, but when the rest of it faded, then this remained.
This was remaining. And tell me, Meredith, do you think it's changed much since you were a baby? Do you think it's getting bigger or darker or more lumpy?
No, it's not. Okay. Well, look, what we're going to do today, Meredith, is we're going to put you to sleep, and while you're asleep, we're going to treat the whole birthmark with the laser. Okay, so all of those increased blood vessels that are under the skin just get cooked, and that all happens without the overlying skin getting damaged.
Have you ever tried putting makeup on it?
No.
No. And do other kids see it? Have other kids ever seen it? Never.
Yes, I think so.
Yeah. Do you cover it up?
Mostly they just see this little part here. Yes. Quite often she's asked if she has a rash.
Yes.
And then has to explain that, no, that's my birthmark.
Yes. Are you proud of your birthmark or do you try and hide it?
Try and hide it.
Hopefully, if it continues to fade after each treatment, I would hope that she probably only need to have 3 or 4 treatments. Gosh. And with any luck, it will fade up to almost, 90-100%.
We switch the lights off, perhaps?
Thank you.
Before we start this operation, we'll finally look at his bladder again through the cystoscope. Here you can see healthy bladder. The area that you can see here is quite definitely cancer. There's no doubt about that. The hope now is that this tumour hasn't spread outside the bladder. We will be looking at his lymph nodes after we open his abdomen. If they're positive, we can't proceed.
This is our operating room. And there's our table. We have to get you to jump up there for us. Good girl. Okay, here comes a mozzie. Bzzz.
Good girl.
You brave girl. Well done. Gee, you were brave. Okay. Okay. Everything's going to be just fine. Can you count to 10?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
That's really good. Now, what about backwards from 10? Can you go 10, 9? I don't think so. She had to get the 10, though. She was really fast. She wanted to get 10 and 9, 10.
Okay. So she's asleep. Right.
Big yawn.
Okay, Mum. We'll see you in recovery as soon as she's awake.
Okay.
We're dissecting down to the pelvic lymph nodes and then. When we get these left pelvic lymph nodes out, we'll send them up with the... They'll be looked at also, and then we'll get a phone call from histopathology which says they're clear or they're not clear. Yeah. If they're clear, we proceed with the operation. If they're not clear, it's not to the patient's advantage to proceed with a massive operation which is not going to cure him. Okay. Now, we're taking out some more tissue from the lymph nodes, and we're hoping these are benign and not malignant.
Okay, can we send those up to frozen section now?
must go to pathology, frozen section.
All right.
Okay?
Yes, certainly. Sha? Thank you. Thank you very much. Good. Right, pelvic lymph nodes, cystadenectomy for carcinoma bladder, frozen section lymph nodes. Very malignancy.
Dr. Arnold, how is he? No problems?
No problems. 5 pieces of adipose tissue. The largest 17 millimetres across.
I think we've been waiting about half an hour so far. It's,
up now. Take another 10 minutes, I suppose.
Oh, this is no good. This has cancer in it. Oh, dear. Oh, hello. It's Dr. Chelyhovsky here in anatomical pathology. I've got some frozen section results for Dr. Khoury.
Mm-hmm.
One of them has transitional cell carcinoma in it.
One of the two.
That's right.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Okay. Yep. You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Left pelvic nodes, one of the two has got transitional cell carcinoma.
Oh.
Right side, they're resectioning because they were small and they have to recut them.
Oh. Well, I don't think there's any sense in proceeding.
No.
We won't proceed with the operation. We'll close the abdomen.
Sure.
Okay.
We'll get...
Thanks very much.
Chemotherapy to come and see him. An oncologist to come and see him.
Oncologist to come and see him.
Take it from there.
Okay.
Okay.
That's a shame.
It's a shame for
we'll now proceed to put everything back the way it was.
You feel better?
Mm. You want?
A lot better.
A lot better?
Yeah. It's really good. Much better than last time, wasn't it?
Just okay. Keep waiting for something to go wrong.
No, nothing's going to go wrong this time. You know that.
You look... I feel a lot stronger and everyone, like the nursing staff, are really good and trying to build your hopes up.
And they're very caring for you, very lucky little girl.
But some people just have such sort of a, you know, organ donation, such a standoffish approach. Maybe it should be more of a, you know, not light-hearted, because it's not a light-hearted subject.
But well, it's someone's tragedy that makes someone else's joy. And what's that sign say on the back of your car? They say don't take your organs to heaven. Heaven knows we need them here.
Yeah, that's right. No, but I feel a lot better. Yeah. Just got to take each day as it comes.
They're starting to give orders, so you must be feeling a bit better.
There's still a long way to go.
Yes, you've got a long, hard road to go, but you'll get there because you're so determined. You're a very special little girl. We're proud of and we all love you.
What you're doing here is you're trying to cover the whole birthmark with the laser, and the little green light is a guiding light to show you where you've been. Generally, the laser treatment itself doesn't worry the children at all. I think they normally go back to kindergarten or school the next day because it's not painful. And generally, the kids at school know they're having treatment anyway, so it's fairly... I think it's fairly non-traumatic to the children. I think the parents often worry more about the child having an anaesthetic and coming into hospital and all of the associated worries.
Okay.
It looks good.
Count to 10 for me.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Good. Now count backwards from 10. 10, 9. Oh, well. He did real well. Okay. Thanks, Mum.
Yeah, have a couple
you know,
of days.
Yeah, okay. See you in recovery as soon as he's awake.
Hello, sweetheart. Hello, darling. Where are you going? Okay? What's going on? You're all right? Where's your neck sore, darling? Pardon, darling? A headache, have you?
Okay.
You just have a little rest. That'll be okay.
What I'm doing here is I'm mainly concentrating on his lip. On the central cheek here, because as you can see, his birthmark started out being as purple as this. I don't know if, see through the hair there, really, really dark purple. And I think it's quite interesting how chatty he is now. When he first started coming here, he just wouldn't say a word. He used to hang his head down a good bit and not look you in the eye, and he was much shyer, I thought.
Tell me a little bit about your seizures. How, when you first had your first seizure and how things have progressed with that.
Right. The first one that I had was about 25 years ago, so it's a long time ago now. Not very far from here, actually, just up at Deaconess House. But I was just serving on the table and I sat down to eat my meal and started to have a fit. Then I had I can't remember how many, but a few more big fits like that just at the same time. And gradually I got onto some tablets which eased it off, and so I didn't have any more of the major ones. I only had just small little fits. Mm-hmm. Michael's got a better idea about those.
Mm-hmm. She still has maybe one a week, and anything could happen. If she's on a train, she can get out the wrong station or get in the wrong train or just do anything, because she hasn't a clue what's going on when she has one of these, and it's a bit can be a bit scary. And the other thing that's going wrong is that she can have psychotic episodes where she has delusions. One time she actually tried to hijack a bus over at Railway Square, I think it was. She just had this idea that she had to get home and that was the way to go, and she jumped up, it was empty, she jumped up into the driver's seat, and the driver was outside somewhere, and she didn't know what to do. She can't drive, she didn't have a clue what to do, and the police came. But
goodness, that must have been a terrible shock, I presume.
Well, it was a bit of shock when I thought she was okay, and suddenly I get a phone call at work to say, we've got your wife in hospital, that she tried to hijack a bus, and good grief.
Gosh. During your time with us, what we will be doing is actually gradually reducing some of your anti-epileptic drugs, and that's in order to bring on a seizure that we can monitor electrically and visually through the camera. Right. The idea is they can identify very specifically where the epileptic foci is in order for maybe to proceed with surgery.
Certainly make a huge difference to us to have some hope of a cure for this.
All right.
Hi, Fiona.
The man that's done all the work.
All the best. All the best to your idea.
Yeah, second time around.
Yeah. It's a great thrill, I think, for all of us.
Yeah.
I'm always a bit chancy the second time around.
Yeah,
chancy enough the first time around.
Hopefully, well, it should work better this time.
Now, you were a crack tennis player once, weren't you?
Was.
Well,
we'll
get you back on the court.
God.
You could join my team of vets.
Oh, I'd probably pay a lot of vets, too.
Anyway, my dear, all the best. We'll be seeing you from time to time.
Oh, I'm sure you will be.
Mm-hmm.
I think once you're attached to this place, you always have to come back.
We've got the hooks in.
Yeah, it's like your second home.
Fine. God bless then.
Okay.
Thanks, Sister. Darren's fine. He's had some fluid through the drip and he's had some antiperspirant, so he should be pretty comfortable.
Mm.
He's not quite woken up yet there.
I just thought, just because Mrs. Blackhall's here and your son's here, we'd better have a chat about what happened at the operation yesterday.
I see.
When we opened you up, we had a look inside. On the right side, which is the side away from the tumour, there was absolutely no sign of spread. But when we looked on the left side, remember I told you we'd take those lymph nodes away before the operation? Unfortunately, they came back showing just on the microscopy that there was some small little tumour cells that had gone to those cells, to those lymph nodes. It wasn't expected. We didn't, you know, all your x-rays beforehand, your bone scan, your abdominal CT scan, was all clear.
Yeah.
Now, the way to treat you, and the best way to treat you, is not to go ahead now and take out your bladder and give you a bag on the side, but to reserve that until such time as that's really necessary. Hmm? And what we plan to do is to give you some chemotherapy. Okay. Now, that sounds bad with your hair loss and all that sort of stuff, but the chemotherapy that they give is fairly gentle, and most patients tolerate it quite well. So it's best to just leave things as they are for the moment, give you the chemotherapy, and then we see how we go after that.
Well, that explains a lot.
Good. Okay. Yeah. I'll come back this afternoon and have another chat to you.
Yeah.
And we'll just talk again about it all and just reinforce it. And you might have some questions then, or you might have something you want to ask me, and we can talk then.
Okay.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Good.
Might think up a few girly ones for you.
You think up all you like, Mr. Blackhall. We're here for you.
Okay, then. Thanks a lot, Doctor.
That wasn't exactly what we were expecting, was it?
Yeah, I was expecting it all to be
gone. Yeah, I thought it was gone.
Not what we were hoping for.
No. But there's not much we can do about it, is there? Nothing we can do except go ahead with the treatment.
Yeah.
Okay, Margaret's about to have a turn, and there's a clock here, and it starts in about another 4 or 5 seconds. She's eating a dinner. She stopped, you see.
So mid-mouth.
So here's the onset, and in a moment she starts to chew automatically. I know she's been eating, but you'll see that all the purpose has gone out of her actions. And she can't carry on with the activities that she was doing, even though she's actually trying quite hard. And if anybody had have noticed her and have gone in and asked her some questions, she'd be unable to answer them or to respond to them.
By almost looking visually out at the nurse's station, you could be forgiven for
not
realising.
Well, if you only glanced at it,
You
would think, oh, well, she's deciding, is the meat any good? Do I really want to eat? But this has gone on for almost a minute now, you see. And this is fairly typical of her attacks. She's found a cable and it goes somewhere, and she's going to track it down. And she's going to pull these leads off any minute now, because she can't stand this stuff, whatever it is. So she's very disoriented now at this stage, you see. Here she says, oh, there's something odd in my head here, I've got to get it off, because she's really out of touch with the fact she's in hospital and she's had a fit. And here she's going to pull this expensive set of electrodes off in this electrode box And it's a tangle, and she wonders what on earth it is, of course, because she can't quite remember or appreciate what's happened. And she's trying to break it all out of there. I hope she's not successful.
Mm.